to celebrate the 25th anniversary of the Coyotes in Arizona. And I've decided that I can't start these. I have to have a greeter, a special greeter. Shane Doan has been my greeter for the first few, but I had to go to the fourth line, and I think he's here now. I'm not sure if he can hear us yet. He
Sweet Lou.
It had to be Louie DeBrusque. Right? Are you okay with that?
How are you doing, bud?
Good to see you, buddy.
Hey, I apologize, Walsh. You know me in time zones. I forgot that it was 3 my time, not 5 my time. So I apologize. I jumped on as quick as I could. Great to see you, Danny. You're looking great, bud.
One of my best roommates ever.
That's why I wanted to have him on for just a couple of minutes. Louie, did you just climb out of a tree stand? Are you hunting deer or Sasquatch? Or what are you doing?
I was looking for Sasquatch in the jungle a little bit. No, you know what? I just was running around today, had a toucan, so it's still not Arizona weather. Let's just say that here in Edmonton, Alberta. But great to see you too, Walsh. You're looking great.
Thanks, Louie. You too. All right, so I won't take too much of your time, Louie, but I want to start this with you because I have a very specific memory. I want to talk about Danny before I talk to him. When you first started your radio gig with the Coyotes, I remember a couple of road trips. We had some very long and very profound conversations about the early years of the Coyotes and your roommate on the road, Danny Briere. So what do you remember about that time and some of the things that you and Danny were talking about? Because you guys were both kind of in weird situations in your lives and your careers, weren't you?
Yeah, you know, and for me, you know, listen, I knew I was a fourth line grind. There was no illusion in my mind where I was going to be in the lineup. But a lot of times when young players would come up, they would be on the fourth line with me. And I remember saying to Danny, you know, listen, I'm sorry that you're going to be on my line. I'll protect you as much as I can. I'll do it. You can do whatever you want out there, but this isn't where you should be playing. And, you know, Danny and I would have those conversations. He was a young guy that was just trying to find his way, but you could just see the talent there. You knew he was so talented and was such a good player. You know, listen, he was getting pressure from an older player, I remember one time, and I'm not going to say who it was. If Danny wants to say, he can. But, you know, and I remember saying to Danny, I said, listen, when you're on the half wall in the power play, you've been around long enough to know when to pass it, when to shoot it, when to make the decision in your mind because you're that good of a player. And, you know, we all saw the shot that he had from that half wall years and years and years where he could bury it. But, you know, I was so proud to see Danny turn into the elite player that he became in the NHL. And, you know, for me, it was just there. You just knew it was there. And you can't meet a nicer human being either. You know, like Disco, you know, I'm not just saying that because I'm talking to you right now. You know, you're just a nice human being. And I just, you know, you want to see people do well, especially people that are kind-hearted and nice. And you know what? Listen, had a terrific career, had an amazing career. Congratulations.
Hey, Danny, thank you very much. Thank you, Lou.
Danny, how important was it now looking back to have a guy like Lou? I mean, these guys, no one has a roommate on the road anymore, right? It's just not the way of the world. And
I know. Yeah. They're missing out.
Right?
I feel the same way, Danny. I loved having roommates. You know what? It was someone to talk to, someone to bounce things off of, and hey, someone to make sure you weren't late for the bus too.
Yeah, well, that's true. That's true. And one of the first thing I have to say is, you know, playing with Louie, I was the toughest 5'9" player in the NHL at the time. So it was actually pretty cool because you knew nobody would even look at you the wrong way. So it was kind of nice. But having a roommate, you know, someone, especially when you're young and you don't know, and the insecurity when you come in this crazy world, you know, all kinds of characters. I mean, you're trying to figure your way out. Having a roommate, having a Louis DeBrusque beside me that I could talk to at night, that I could bounce ideas off, you know, saved me, honestly. You know, and that's why I said I believe those guys are missing out these days. I can't imagine going back to my room having to deal with that on my own, you know, alone in my room at the time. So, you know, thank you to you two for helping me out through those struggles. Yeah. It was awesome having you around.
Yeah, you know, we had some good talks. You know, it was funny. You bring that up, but that was what it was all about. That was about, you know, breaking stuff down, making sure you were comfortable talking about stuff. And I don't know, maybe that's why I was always with young guys. It seemed like everywhere I went, I was always, you know, paired up with a young guy. And obviously I wasn't competition too. You know, I think that was by design. I was a big guy, you know, an older guy at that time. And I could just kind of maybe be a calming presence. So, but I always appreciate skill. You know, Danny, I've always loved skill. Everybody wants to be a skilled player. I was no different. You know, I wish I could use these for something a little different. But you know what? That was fun. We had great conversations, and I agree with you, especially in the time now with the pandemic and the players by themselves, a lot of time to sit there and absorb things. They just don't have that, the ability to bounce things off of one another. It'd be tough. So, you know, hopefully they're getting by. And listen, I have a young kid that's playing right now. He's not playing the greatest right now. He's trying to figure it out. And, you know, we talk a lot, and that's, you have to talk those things out, and you have to try and work it out so you can get on the right track.
Yeah. And I see that he has the skills too. You probably told him to focus on the skills.
Yeah. I might have
great,
to tell him
great
focus
player.
On this
He's
a
fun
little
to watch.
Bit. Yeah, I know. Thanks, man. Yeah. Thank God he got all the skill that I didn't get.
Hey, Louie, before I let you go, I know you weren't there that night. I sent you the video. Danny, Louie used to do a segment on my pregame show called The Fight Doctor. I sent you the Mike Comrie, Danny Briere tilt. I mean, how many props can you give him for what he did that night at America West Arena?
Well, you know, the thing about Comrie, too, that people don't realize, he was a scrappy guy. He was actually a pretty good fighter. So, you know, the funny thing about that game, and I did do a little research on, looked at it, Danny had a couple goals in that game, and Comrie had 3 assists in that game. You guys were both just one stat away from the Gordie Howe hat trick, both of you. And but you know what? It was an incredible fight. It was an amazing fight. And you know what? He came out early out of the gates. You came back in the middle, and then both of you got on in the late rounds. It was like the bantamweights going after it. I was like, this is incredible. But yeah, I love seeing that. You know what? Those are usually the best fights, because you know what? You're fighting for your life, and it showed. That was an awesome tilt, man. That was an awesome tilt, Danny.
I didn't know what I was doing. I didn't know what I was doing. I was swinging. But I'll be honest, I was very selective in my opponents throughout my career. So, but he was definitely a feisty little guy.
Yep.
I love it. Yep. Hey, Danny, I'll send you Louie off, or I'll let you send Louie off. Can you believe what we're talking about when we talk about Louie DeBrusque? He speaks to an entire country about the sport that he played, that he loves, that is his life story. He is on hockey night in Canada. Yeah. If you had told your roommate on the road back in the day, don't worry, Louie, everything's going to be okay, would you believe what you're saying?
At the time, I was so afraid, so insecure, that I probably would not have a clue, but I'm not surprised. When I think back, Louie was very thoughtful, understood a lot of experience on and off the ice too. I remember some conversation, you know, just guiding me off the ice too, in my personal life. So just the experience that he was able to share, I have to admit that I'm not surprised, and really, really happy to see him. Great personality, easy to talk to. It's a perfect place for him.
Louie, well, you're not alone. I wouldn't have believed it either. Fourth line grind on hockey night in Canada, but I'll take it. You know what? It's been an amazing journey.
Can you put your toque on before you go? You just want to see. Is it around?
Sure.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, hold on a second.
I just want you to know a Yeti walked by while you were talking.
Hold on a second. This is, you know, I want to make myself look like I'm going to be ready for him if he comes my way. Bring it on.
Oh, boy. We're back in the days now.
Yeah, back in the days, right? You know, it's almost like you're going to train, right? You know, doing the road work. Yeah, Rick Tockett and I used to call it the road work all the time. That's the grinding hard work you do before you get into the fight. But listen, it's been great to catch up with you two. Two of my favorites. Walsh, always a pleasure seeing you, bud. And Disco, it's been a long time, but you look the same, kid. I think you look awesome.
Sweet, Lou. Thanks for coming on. I really appreciate it. It was fun seeing you.
All right.
Thanks, Louie.
Yep, for sure. Anytime, boys.
Yep.
Have a good chat. Okay.
All right. So, Danny, there you go. We have your official greeter in the form of Louie DeBrusque.
What an awesome surprise. I didn't see that coming at all. I didn't expect it. It was really cool to see him again.
I've never forgotten him telling the story. We were on a long trip back east, and your name came up. You had done something that night in the league, and he told me about those nights. So I really wanted to make sure that we connected with him. So let's go. Let's do This Is Your Life, if we could, Danny, one-on-one here on the podcast. Can you tell us about your job right now, your job title with the Maine Mariners, but really how all-encompassing that title is? What are you doing these days?
So I'm the president/governor for the Maine Mariners and ECHL team. It's Double A of hockey. We're affiliated with the last 3 years, we're affiliated with the New York Rangers, even though we're owned by the Philadelphia Flyers group. So I know it sounds a little weird, but just the proximity. The New York Rangers have their affiliate AHL team in Hartford, Connecticut. So it's close to Portland, Maine. That's why the proximity helped. So that's what I'm doing there. I'm in charge of both hockey side and business side. So on the business side is selling advertising, finding corporate sponsors, selling tickets, season tickets, groups. So I'm learning about all that, the marketing, finance, all these different departments. Social media is obviously a big one nowadays. Mm-hmm. And also in charge, acting as the GM for the hockey team, following a salary cap and finding players, recruiting as well, because we don't have much staff. So everybody has to do a little bit of everything. On the hockey side, it's myself and Riley Armstrong. He's the head coach, assistant GM, and the two of us do most of the work on the hockey side.
So I think of Shane Doan here as the, I write it down, chief hockey development officer, but the key for his success to me, I think, is the intangible that he went and worked for the league and he got to see so many other things. I think of you in that regard right now, because someone's going to come calling and they're going to bring you into the league again in management now. And it's going to be about what you're doing right now, isn't it, Danny?
I hope so. I hope so at some point. You know, and I try to be careful where I don't want to get lost. You know, when I played, I was so worried every day about coming to the rink and wondering which line am I going to be on? Am I going to be on the power play? What's going to happen tomorrow? So, you know, I live that way as a player. It's the intensity of it's the survival as a hockey player, trying to hang around, you know, as long as possible. So what I'm trying to do now is enjoy the moment, enjoy what I'm going through right now. I love what I'm doing. You know, both hockey side and business side, it gives me, throws different things at me every day. So I love it. You know, eventually if there's a chance to move up, to the NHL, that'd be awesome. But, I'm really enjoying what's going on right now and building this, this team from scratch.
Well, can we take a Kachina Coyote journey together for a few minutes? Do you mind?
Love that.
Okay. I keep showing this to everybody I talk to, but this is the original one. It has the slice in the neck so you can breathe.
Yeah.
When you see this and when you think about draft day and you're actually one of the first two first round picks in the Coyotes history, where does this Kachina take you, Danny, in your head?
Oh my God. It was the start of the journey. It was, you know, as a player, as a teenager, you dream of being drafted by an NHL team. My year, it was the year that the Jets were moving to Arizona. And honestly, it was still the Jets, the day of the draft. Oh. A week later, the sale was official. Everybody knew they were going there. But officially, it was still the Jets. And I was presented with a jersey. It was a practice jersey with the logo that you just showed. So that was my draft jersey, actually. And, you know, it was all the work that was done before in minor hockey. I think it was a great reward for my parents as well.
Sure.
All the sacrifices that they have put up with for me to play hockey. I think that moment was a lot about them cherishing that with them. So, you know, to me, yeah, that was the start. I look back and it brings so many great memories, even though it's not where my career probably took off. It was the beginning of it. It's where I learned a lot those early years.
I just remember looking up your stats in junior and I had having to pull out my calculator, which I did again today, 170 goals in 3 years. And I thought, can't wait to see this guy. But I was looking on your social media just to get ready and I saw a story and I'd love for you to relate it here. I'd never heard this before or I'd forgotten it, but March 19th, I think I have the date, 1998, America West Arena, the Avs and the Coyotes, your NHL debut. Does that sound right?
That's right.
Your first shift. Can you tell that story? I love this story. This is unbelievable. What happened?
Yeah, so I was on the bench my first NHL game against the Avalanche, and I thought, you know, this is surreal, first of all, for a Canadian kid having a chance to play in the NHL. And I'm playing against Colorado, who has all those stars. My one of my idol, Patrick Waugh, net, you know, and there's a couple of shifts that go by, and finally, Jim Schoenfeld calls my name to go out on the ice, and I'm staring down Mike Stapleton because that's who I'm changing for, and I see him coming from across the ice. So now my heart is thumping, and I finally get a leg over the board when he's about 20 feet away. When he gets to about 5 or 6 feet away, I finally swing my other leg over the board to jump on the ice for my first ever NHL shift. And I never saw Peter Forsberg creeping up the wall along the bench. And as I'm about to jump, he just punched me right in the chest and I went back into our bench. So that was my almost first NHL shift. So it was a tough start, but it makes it pretty special that it was from Peter Forsberg.
Peter Forsberg. Yeah, I'll bet. Thank you for repeat. I somehow missed that, but I know you weren't on the inaugural team, but you were in the first few years here. And I say this every time, you guys were hockey pioneers in the desert. And you were selling the game, Danny. You guys are out shaking hands and kissing babies and doing street hockey clinics and Zamboni parades. You'll always be a part of that here. What do you remember most about that aspect of it? A, you're trying to make it and stay, but you're also, you had to sell the game, didn't you?
Yeah. It was very different in a sense that a lot of people didn't know what hockey was. I think one of the most fun I've had was when we would go, I think it was the power play caravan, they used to call it. And you would go across the state to different towns and sign autographs and just show some displays of hockey with some of the Coyote staff. So that was some of this, you know, funnest time that I had there, going through the communities and trying to introduce hockey to people that didn't know what the Coyotes were. So it was so different, but at the same time, you know, it's really cool that the Coyotes are still there, still around, you know, and I still keep tab on what's going on. Obviously Shane Doan is one of my closest friend. So I cheer for him very hard, but the Coyotes were, it's like your first love, right? You don't forget it.
No. And Danny, you were so front and center, you were a fan favorite, and there are pictures of you that I see all over the place from days gone by and the Coyote Carnival, which was a big deal. And one of those pictures has gained considerable traction because it's you with a aspiring hockey player from Arizona who went on to be, I know you know this, the first pick in the draft, Austin Matthews. And he credits you. He idolized your game, your goal, celebration. And I know you reached out to him via Twitter after his four-goal National Hockey League debut. But look back now and realize that signing autographs, shaking hands, taking photos, and playing the game the way you played set Austin Matthews on the path. That's pretty cool, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, it's amazing. And you know, there's two sides to it. Selfishly, obviously, for myself, having a guy like Austin Matthews, first overall pick, come out and say, you know, I used to watch Daniel Briere. I have a picture. Actually, when he was at a camp in the summer, one summer, maybe 6 or 7 years ago, his dad came over to me and showed me the picture with Austin and his sister from the carnival. You know, so that's the selfish side. But on the other side, I mean, it's amazing that we were able to you know, entice a young kid from Arizona to really dedicate his life to hockey and become one of the best player in the game today, top three players in the NHL right now. That to me is what's so amazing about the story, and what I'm so proud to having been involved in that story.
I just remember how hot it was during those Coyote carnivals. And I remember management getting mad and saying, we can't do this to these players on an off day. I don't know why, but Dan, those early teams, I know there was some heartbreak in the first round of the playoffs, but you guys were a fun team to watch, a tough out, legitimate superstars, Keith Tkachuk, Jeremy Roenick, Teppo Niemenen, Nikolai Hopi-Bolin, up and coming players like yourself. What do you remember about the style of play that the then Phoenix Coyotes had?
I mean, we were a team that you didn't know what you were getting. There's some nights we could have been the best NHL team. And then some other nights, it was nowhere to be found. So, you know, there's a lot of inconsistencies, but I mean, firepower, you know, the players that you mentioned, and we could go down the list. I mean, Mike Gartner and Rick Tocchet, Greg Adams, Cliff Ronning, you know, so there's so many great players, you know, throughout the lineup that, you know, we weren't easy to play against. You know, it just depended which team would show up. But it was, you know, as far as learning for myself, the development, having the chance to be around all these star players and a few superstars mixed in the group, for my development, it was amazing.
I have to get to March 10th, 2003. I have a very specific memory of the feeling of that night at Pepsi Center in Denver. It was a 2-2 tie into overtime. I think you rang one off the post or the crossbar, which I think sent shockwaves into the management suite because they had already agreed in terms to trading you, which was announced after the game. I get chills thinking about it, Danny, because I just felt the emotion, the raw emotion. I've been around the game for a while then, but that one hit home because of how everyone felt about it in the room. And then you flew back with the team, if memory serves, right? Do you remember the whirlwind of that?
I remember, but at the same time, it was like I was floating on a cloud somewhere. It was totally surreal. And what was weird is during the game, I didn't play a lot, you know, especially in the second and third period. And I think the trade was probably done somewhere around the second period. And I barely played and I didn't know what was going on. I hadn't done anything wrong. You know, so it was weird that I wasn't playing. And then we get to overtime. And in that 5 minutes overtime, I must have been on the ice for like 3 minutes of that. So I get off the ice and I'm completely exhausted. I can barely breathe because we're in Colorado as well. I'm searching for air. And Rick Bonus, I think it was Rick Bonus, walked by and said, can you come in a coach's room? Bobby Francis wants to see you. So, and I'm out of breath. I still have my Coyotes jersey on. And I'm thinking, okay, he needs to show me a clip. I must have made, you know, missed an assignment or something. So I walked in the room and I sat down and I could tell something was wrong immediately. Bobby was deflated. And he just said, Danny, I'm so sorry. We made a trade during the game and, you know, you're the player going to Buffalo. And yeah, it was surreal. I was selling my Coyotes jersey on. And it was the first time in really my hockey career that I had that rejection. You know, I'd never been traded even in juniors before. Nobody had never said no to me. You're not good enough. You can't play on this team. So it was the first time that I was, you know, I felt that rejection. So it was really weird, tough to take. You know, and I got home and I didn't sleep. I was on a plane the next morning at 6 a.m. You know, and the opposite happens after a trade. You know, the first is the moment of rejection. And then when I got to Buffalo is the opposite. Now all of a sudden they're excited to have you and you feel the other side of the medal. It was tough. It was a tough moment to go through.
I watched it. I had a front row seat and it was hard. It seems though, as the years went on, every time we saw you somewhere, and it was always obviously in Buffalo or Philadelphia, there was talk. Coyote's going to try and get Danny back. And I don't know if that was all about Shane Doan, but do you remember any of those discussions? And was that a possibility ever along the way coming back here?
I don't remember, you know, that it was very serious.
Okay.
You know, and obviously, like I said earlier, it was my first love, right? So you always keep track. You always follow suit. I still had a lot of friends on the team. So, you know, I would have been the first one in line if that was a possibility, to go back to Phoenix. Like I said, I keep the good memories. I still have lots of friends in the Valley, you know, in the Coyotes organization. You know, I mean, Shane Doan, we talked about yourself, Rich Nairn, just to mention a few, Stan Wilson, as well. So there's a lot of good people that I missed there. And also a lot of friends off the ice too, buddies that, you know, I spend my early 20s with, hanging around, in the desert, that I miss and that I still keep in touch with, to this day.
In the end, Danny, now looking back, 17 years, just shy of 1,000 games, over 300 goals, just shy of 700 points. And I think the ultimate marker, 116 playoff points in 124 playoff games. Would that 20-something-year-old Danny Briere sitting there with Louis DeBrusque in the middle of a, you know, 5-day road trip somewhere, would you have believed it if I had told you that then, that that was coming, that it was going to happen and the game would do that for you?
Probably not. Mm. I wish Lou could have stepped up and told me to relax and then just enjoy the ride, because there was a lot of sleepless night. Yeah. And, you know, I think he was the perfect guy to come here and introduce myself. It was really cool to see him, because that's where it started with him. Those talks, he probably he helped me out a lot more than people realize.
You had to have the edge, though. The edge is what pushes you, right? You can't be comfortable. Never. It just doesn't work.
Correct. And you know, I when I look back, you know, I didn't have the build to make it amongst this world of giants. But I tell people, if I would have been 6'2", 6'3", and 200 pounds, I don't know that I would have had the same want to prove people wrong. Chip on my shoulder to prove them wrong. So in a sense, that probably played in my favor.
Well, you're always going to be the one that got away to me, but I think it had to happen that way. I don't know why. It just seems like it's in the stars, but I have a phrase that somebody taught me along the way in 25 years of watching this sport in this league, that if you're good to the game will be good to you. And I know how good you were to the game, and I hope it continues to return the favor to you, Danny. But you are such a big part of the early history of this franchise. I'm glad you're still watching the team, and I'm glad you're still connected. They are the first love. It's a great way to put it. I appreciate that. Thanks for going one-on-one with me. I hope you enjoyed it as much as I didn't want this to end, by the way, but thank you.
I love it. I love it. And you know what? It's really cool that you and I are both doing it together still after, you know, 23, 24 years. So that's really cool as well.
Oh, I miss you, Danny. I hope you can see it in my eyes whenever I see it. I just have nothing but unbelievable memories. And as I've said to the guys that I've been talking to, you all help validate my existence around the sport, because you help bring it to me in my head. And I mean, we're all trying to figure it out, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
It's a complicated game, and you have to understand it and the people in it, or it will run right past you.
Exactly.
Good on you, man. Thanks, Dave Breer.
Thank you so much, Walsh. It was good spending time with you.